to begin. I am Betty Deer. I'm one of the school counselors from Iroquois, and we welcome you this morning. We're thrilled to death that you're here. I am not going to take a lot of time with introductions because we are running a little bit behind, but we have two dynamic ladies here with us this morning that are just a wealth of knowledge that they're going to share with you. And I'm hoping that you will take that knowledge and share with your peers, your colleagues, students, and family and friends. So without further ado, I'm going to ask Jessica Hutchings to come up. She is the program director for Face-to-Face at Kids Escaping Drugs. And if there's anything else that she wants to share with you, she will share that as far as her, how long she's been there and her little bit of a bio. The other thing that we do want to say to Jess is congratulations. She is expecting. Mr. Hutchings and Jessica are expecting, so we're thrilled to death for her, and I think the baby is due in May. So, Jess?
It's all yours. Good morning to all of you. For those who know me, nice to see you. For those I've never met, my name is Jessica Hutchings. I work for an organization called Kids Escaping Drugs, and I run a program there called Face-to-Face, which you'll hear all about today if you're not familiar with it. My background's in social work. I received both my bachelor's and my master's degree in social work. Graduated from UB with my master's in 2009, and I've been working for Kids Escaping Drugs ever since. When I started working for the organization, I knew very, very little about addiction with adolescents. And everything that I've learned and everything that I'm going to share with you, I've learned from teenagers who have lived through struggles with addiction. You know, what's great about our organization is that we're closely affiliated with the Renaissance campus, which you'll also learn about today. And so we have the ability to learn about the cutting edge trends of adolescent substance use from young people who are going through it. And then we can take that information fresh off the streets and do a little bit of research and get that back out to you long before the research in the field catches up. So my goal in presenting to you this morning is to kind of give you a snapshot of everything that's happening with teenagers in terms of substance abuse. For those of you who have heard me present before, some of it will be familiar to you. There are some new up and coming substances that I've added to the presentation. And if you guys have questions, I'll be happy to answer them when I get through with the presentation. So a little bit of background on Kids Escaping Drugs. We are a foundation that was established over 25 years ago because at that time, there was no place anywhere in Western New York for adolescents to go if they developed an addiction. There was nowhere they could go for residential treatment. There was nowhere that their families could reach out for support. And 25 years ago, I think society in general didn't really see addiction as something that impacted teenagers. You know, people talked about addiction in adults, but nobody really thought about how a teenager could possibly be a drug addict or an alcoholic. And 25 years ago, the teenagers that we were treating and assisting were drinking alcohol, they were smoking marijuana. Every once in a while, we would meet a young person who was blowing cocaine and became addicted. What we were not seeing happen all those years ago, we were not seeing young people abusing prescription drugs. We were not seeing them sticking needles into their veins and injecting heroin. And we were not seeing them losing their lives to overdoses at very young ages. And unfortunately, in Western New York right now, that's what we deal with on a weekly basis and sometimes on a daily basis. I never imagined in a million years when I began working for KED that attending funerals would become part of the norm of what I have to do. And unfortunately, it has. In 2009, when I started working for Kids Escaping Drugs, I attended one funeral for one boy who lost his life to an overdose. In 2015, we went to 34. Those were just kids who we had either treated on our campus. They were kids who were close friends of kids we had treated on our campus that we had gotten to know. There were countless others that we didn't know personally who also lost their lives. So I think that number in and of itself demonstrates the severity of the epidemic that we're dealing with in Western New York. And I'm happy to be here kind of giving you all an education about that today because I truly believe that becoming educated is the first step in doing something to address this epidemic. The long story short is that 25 years ago, when the drug problem was not nearly as terrible as it is today, we still had this need in Western New York for a place for teenagers and their families to go. So Kids Escaping Drugs raised several million dollars, and that money was used to build a place called the Renaissance Campus. If you're not familiar with the Renaissance Campus, it's located in West Seneca. It's right near the corner of Clinton and Harlem Road, and it is a residential rehab facility for teenagers. We treat kids on our campus for an average length of stay of anywhere from 5 to 6 months, so it's long-term residential treatment. Our youngest patients on our campus are 12 years old, and our oldest patients at our facility are 21. Now, when we get a kid checking into rehab at the age of 12 or 13, that doesn't happen very frequently. But when it does, we find that those kids began to dabble with alcohol and marijuana, usually around the age of 8 or 9, which is an alarmingly young age for us to see kids begin to use. However, what we find in those situations is that in most cases, there's either a parent using substance in the home or an older sibling. And if you think back to when your own children were 8 or 9, or your students were 8 or 9, they look up to their parents and their siblings. And if those people are using substance in front of them, that doesn't seem like such a scary thing to do. And so by the time they get to be 12 or 13, they've progressed to the point where they're full-blown addicted. The average age of a patient on campus right now is probably somewhere between 16 and 18. And most of those young people began their experimentation with substances around the age of 12, which is right on par with the national average. I deal with parents every day who think that they don't need to be having conversations with their middle school students about substance abuse. That could not be more wrong. These kids are beginning to experiment in those middle school years, and usually by the time they've gotten to high school, they've pretty much made up their mind whether or not this is going to be something that they choose to do. So we really feel that the middle school years are a great time to really have an impact and have an influence on those decisions. A little bit more about the campus. It is the most intensive type of treatment that's available to a young person in Western New York. There is nowhere else an adolescent can go and receive more intensive care than they will receive on our campus. Quite frankly, there's really not any other residential facility that's licensed by New York State to provide services to someone under the age of 18. The next closest rehab facility to ours that will treat a teenager is the other side of the Pennsylvania border, or all the way over on the other side of the city of Syracuse. So we are truly the only New York State licensed option for teenagers who struggle with addiction. Our patients go through 4 phases of treatment while they're at the facility. They have different goals and objectives that they have to meet on each of those phases before they're able to progress into the next. So even though we've been treating up to 62 individuals at any given time, they're going through those phases of treatment at very, very different rates based on what their own individual needs are. The thing we're most proud of on the Renaissance campus is how involved in treatment our families are. Most of our families are local, not all of them. We service all 8 counties of Western New York, as well as other parts of New York State, and honestly, we've had kids from other parts of the country come for treatment as well if they have trouble accessing treatment in their hometown. And for the families who are local, they have the opportunity to be involved in their child's treatment up to 3 days a week. We offer programming for families. And they come in, they learn about the disease of addiction, they learn about how to support their children in their recovery, they meet other families who are going through similar struggles so that they can develop a support network. And from the day their child checks into rehab and until the day they graduate, we're working with those families on a plan as to how they're going to support their children when they come home. Our campus is not a place where parents can send their kids and say, fix them, I'll come back and get them in 6 months. It doesn't happen that way on our campus. And we find that the families who are very involved in treatment, their children tend to do better in their recovery than those who are not. Our patients continue their education while they're on our campus. We have a whole education department on campus which contracts with all the school districts in Western New York. So if a student from whatever school district comes to the Renaissance campus for treatment, they're still receiving their education while they're there. They either remain on track to return to middle school or high school. They have the opportunity to pursue the task. We are licensed to prep them for that and test them for the task. And many of our older kids decide to take that track because returning to the high school environment is a very, very difficult thing to do when you're in recovery, because you have made all these changes and nobody else at school has made the same. And so you're returning to an environment that frequently has not changed. So we have a lot of kids who pursue the task. We have a lot of patients who have graduated high school prior to coming into rehab. Those kids have the opportunity to do voc ed courses. They can do an apprenticeship on campus. They can take online college courses from any of the local universities. But we require all of our patients, regardless of their age, to be doing some type of instructional learning every day for a minimum of 2 hours a day all year round. They don't get summers off the way a traditional student does. They don't get breaks the way a traditional student does. And what we find with most of the patients that we treat on the campus is that they're all intelligent kids. They're just not going to school because they're getting high every day. So for many of them, they need to just catch up on their seat time. And so we have the ability to assist them in doing that. And they don't really fall too far behind at all in their schooling while they're there. When they're not working on their schooling, they're involved in a lot of therapeutic work. Pretty much every hour of the day, something therapeutic is going on. They're doing individual counseling sessions, group counseling sessions. Their families come in for sessions, both with the child and independent from the child. We're doing a lot of specialty groups on our campus. Our kids come in with a whole lot of other issues outside of their substance use. We're running groups on grief and loss on a weekly basis. Most of our patients have lost a friend or a loved one to the disease of addiction. We're running groups on anger management. A lot of them are clueless as to how to control their emotions without being under the influence. We're running groups on self-esteem. We're doing a lot of trauma-informed care on our campus. We've found that the majority of our patients are either using due to something traumatic that happened in their life, or something traumatic has happened to them as a result of their addiction. So we're dealing with all of that. We have also found that over 50% of our patients have a mental health diagnosis in addition to their substance abuse diagnosis. So we have a licensed mental health counselor, as well as a nurse practitioner who specializes in psychiatry, both working on our campus, so that we can assist these kids with their mental health struggles and their substance abuse struggles all at the same time. Historically, that did not happen in the treatment world. If you struggled with mental health and substance use, you were kind of ping-pong back and forth between those two different silos of care. And so we're proud to be able to offer all of that at the same time. So Kids Escaping Drugs as a foundation for the last 25 plus years has raised money to offer services to families that struggle with addiction, and we will continue to do that. We will continue to raise money to support the kids that need the treatment. But over the last decade or so, we have really expanded our mission statement a great deal to include community outreach. And this is where our face-to-face program comes into play. Face-to-face is the program that I'm proud to run for Kids Escaping Drugs. For those of you who are familiar faces to me, you know all about face-to-face. That's how we know each other. For those of you who aren't familiar to me, I'll take a couple of minutes and explain to you what we offer. Face-to-face is all about going out into the community and educating students, parents, educators, the general public, anybody who's willing to listen to me talk about the dangers and the consequences of addiction, as well as the ever-changing signs and symptoms and trends. And we do these, we get this information out there in a lot of different ways. The first thing that we offer is a peer-to-peer education program. And this program is available to all middle schools and high schools in Western New York. We bring young people who are in recovery, primarily kids who have graduated from our treatment facility. We bring them into the schools and they share their story about addiction. When they share their story, they are focusing heavily on the consequences that addiction brought into their life. So they are talking about what it was like to be arrested in front of their mom and for her to be sobbing because she's so upset. They're talking about what it felt like to lose Division I scholarships, both academically and athletically, because they couldn't perform without being under the influence. They're talking about the embarrassment that they felt when they were arrested from their place of employment because they were stealing from the company. They talk about what it's like to spend days, weeks, months in the Erie County Holding Center because they've gotten arrested for drug-related charges. They also talk about how their life has improved since they've gotten clean and sober. And probably the most important thing they share is that now they are living life in recovery back in wherever their hometown was, and they don't feel that daily pressure to pick up a drink or a drug because they're working a program. What the kids in the schools tell us after they hear this message is that hearing that from somebody their own age has such a greater impact for them than any type of authoritative figure giving them the typical just say no talk. They need the just say no talks. We support those 100%, but they also need to be educated on what the potential consequences are if they don't say no. And that's what we're trying to offer through Kids Escaping Drugs. When we bring our kids in to speak into the schools, they are always accompanied by a drug and alcohol counselor who facilitates that discussion and facilitates the Q&A that follows. We offer these programs in both an auditorium-style setting, and we will also come into the classroom and do multiple sessions for several days if it's necessary to hit all the kids in health or all the kids in English, however you want to work it. And we offer that to any school district at no cost. It is a first-come, first-served program, so if you are interested and you want to tie it into your health unit or your PE unit or whatever it might be, get us those dates sooner than later because our calendar does book up really fast. Historically, Kids Escaping Drugs has done a lot of education for adults, primarily through schools. We will come and speak to parents at open houses, freshman orientations, locker pickout days, whatever functions you might host for the parents of the students in your district. And what we found with those presentations is that, first of all, they're not always super well attended. Parents can't always be at something that takes place at 6 or 7 o'clock in the evening. And we also found that those presentations are not always very inviting to other adults who care about these kids, whether it be their grandparents, their aunts, their uncles, their neighbors, members from their church community. And in the light of the heroin epidemic that we're dealing with in Western New York, Kids Escaping Drugs really wanted to come up with a way to make it more convenient for adults who care about kids to learn about this epidemic. And so in July of 2015, we launched a program called Face to Face in the Workplace. And what we are doing now is focusing on different employers in Western New York and encouraging them to give the give their employees the opportunity to learn about this topic primarily through EAP providers. So we're doing that for any company or organization in Western New York at no cost. My favorite audience to talk to are people like you guys, education professionals, because not only may you guys be parents, but you're also working with adolescents every day for your full-time job. So the presentation that I'm going to give to you is very, very similar to what we offer through Face-to-Face in the Workplace. In addition to what you'll see today, Face-to-Face in the Workplace also includes a parent telling the story of her two sons who struggled with addiction. So if you find this program informative and you believe that your colleagues could benefit from this, please have your building principals call us and schedule a staff development session. We will come to any district anywhere in Western New York and provide this for the staff of the schools, again, at no cost. You guys spend 8 hours a day with teenagers. It's so important for you and your colleagues to be aware of this epidemic and what we're seeing from the adolescent perspective. We'll still do the stuff for the parents in the schools. We're happy to do that. But we're really trying to reach more people through the workplace as well. We also offer an early intervention program. This is what I like to call the reactive piece to the proactive face-to-face community outreach that we're doing. The early intervention program was designed to work with students who are at risk of developing a drug problem. These are kids who are being caught by their parents with something they shouldn't have. These are kids who might bring something to the school building that they absolutely shouldn't have at school. When that happens, the standard across Western New York for suspension tends to be as few as 5 days to as many as 16 weeks out of school. And the last thing a parent wants to hear when their child is dabbling with drugs and alcohol is that their kid is going to sit home for 16 weeks while they go to work all day long. It's the last thing you want to happen. So many of the school districts that partner with us on this early intervention program have tied this program to that discipline process. And if a student comes for the early intervention program and follows through with any clinical recommendations that one of the two counselors make, the school reduces the suspension up to half. That's a huge motivator to get these families in the door and get them addressing something that very oftentimes they are paralyzed in fear about. You know, for a lot of parents, when they get that call from the school social worker or the principal or the counselor, whoever it might be, that their child was caught with marijuana in school, that's the first inclination that they might have that their child's using. And that information hits them like a ton of bricks, and they don't know where to turn. So if you have students who are suspended for something drug or alcohol related and you want to refer them to this program, we also offer this program at no cost to any family anywhere in Western New York. And we can usually get a family in for these appointments within 72 hours of when they contact us. The goal of this program is to assess where the child's at in that substance use and link them up with the appropriate level of intervention within their home community so that that experimentation doesn't have the opportunity to progress into a full-blown addiction. And we have them sign releases for the school district while they're there so that we can communicate back with you and let you know, yep, Johnny came, he participated, and these are the clinical recommendations that we made for him. So when we go into the schools, we always ask the students to describe to us, what's the first thing that comes to your mind when you hear the word drug addict or alcohol. And from their perspective, it's always a man with dirty hair and yellow teeth and ripped and tattered clothes, and he usually lives under a bridge with a paper bag in his hand. From their perspective, it is rarely ever a woman. It's not somebody who gets up and comes to work every day, and it's certainly never a teenager. And that stereotype of addiction is preventing a lot of teenagers from believing that they could ever struggle with addiction. And even more so than that, it's preventing a lot of parents from recognizing that their child could be struggling with addiction. If you go on Google and you type in the word drug addict or alcoholic, this is one of the many images that will come up on the screen for you. And this stereotype, I think in general, has allowed society to believe that addiction impacts a certain type of person. And what we're seeing right now is that addiction does not discriminate. It is impacting everybody from every walk of life. And from our perspective, your typical average American who struggles with addiction looks a lot more like this. The kids that we are treating on our campus come from urban areas, rural areas, suburban areas. Their parents are doctors, lawyers, politicians, state troopers. You name it, we've treated it. And it truly does not discriminate. And so much of what we're doing when we go out into the community is not only trying to educate about the signs and the symptoms and the trends, but we're also trying to break through these stereotypes and help these families recognize that, you know, if your child develops a drug problem, it's not something to be ashamed of. It's something to do something about immediately instead of living with that shame and that embarrassment and that awful stigma that comes with this disease. So I want to spend the majority of the time I have with you this morning painting you a picture of what kids are using, how they're using it, and how we found ourselves in the midst of the epidemic that we're dealing with. And with teenagers, for the most part, that typically still starts with alcohol and marijuana. These substances are very socially accepted among kids. They are easy for teenagers to access, and they are so much more concentrated than they once were. Think about a light beer, a bottle of Bud Light, a can of Blue Light. Typically, it's a 12-ounce serving. And typically, that 12-ounce serving will contain anywhere from 3.5% to maybe 4% alcohol per serving. Now, there are products on the market like Bud Light Platinum and Blue Light Royal, which are marketed as light beers. They taste just like light beers. They come in the same 12-ounce can or bottle, but the alcohol concentration is far from light. As you see, both of those products contain 6% alcohol as opposed to 3.5% or 4%. We have IPA beers that have become very, very popular in Western New York. All the places that are doing their own craft beers have an IPA. And your typical 12-ounce serving of an IPA has anywhere from 8 to 12% alcohol per 12-ounce serving. We have products on the market like Johnny Bootlegger, which is what you see in the bottom center of the screen. Johnny Bootlegger, if you've never heard of it, it comes in a small glass bottle. That bottle is shaped just like a flask. Kids love it because it fits in their pocket really nicely. It's a flat bottle. It's intended to be mixed with soda or juice or seltzer of some kind. It's kind of very sweet in flavor. It kind of has like a syrupy texture to it. Kids don't mix it with anything. They unscrew that little metal cap off the top, they swing it back just like you'd swing back a flask, and they drink this stuff straight. On average, it contains 12% alcohol. Another product that's very popular with teenagers is 4 Loko. 4 Loko, the combination of 4 Loko has been changed 10 times over. When 4 Loko first hit the market, it was a combination of alcohol and caffeine. Since that time, the caffeine has been removed from the product. However, it's still very, very highly concentrated in alcohol. It comes in a 20-ounce can. It looks just like one of those Arizona iced tea cans. You can buy it at any gas station or convenience mart in Western New York. And you know, you or I might see 16% alcohol volume stamped on that can, and we might think, whoa, one can is more than enough for the night. Kids don't do that either. In their mind, one can equals one drink. They crack it open, they pound it down. It's carbonated, it's fruity, it's sweet tasting, and they're off to the races. Now, you look at 4 Loko. One 23.5-ounce can of 4 Loko at 12% alcohol volume, which isn't even the highest that it can be, contains the same amount of alcohol as 4.7 shots of 80-proof vodka, 4.7 bottles of beer, or 4.7 glasses of wine. So you can see how if they're cracking open these cans and chug-a-lugging, how quickly this can add up. And what we're seeing happen with teenagers, because these products are so highly concentrated, we're seeing them be hospitalized for alcohol intoxication. We are seeing kids get DWIs at the age of 16 and 17 years old, and we have the opportunity to talk to these kids after these experiences, and they report back to us, you know what, I didn't think it was a big deal. This is something I picked up at Tops or Wegmans or the convenience store, and I didn't really think twice about it. And so they are becoming very, very intoxicated at very, very rapid rates. We are seeing something very, very similar happen with marijuana. Marijuana in and of itself is nothing like the marijuana of 20 or 30 years ago. Nothing like it. First of all, the THC content in marijuana right now is double what it was 20 or 30 years ago. What's more concerning than that is 90% of the marijuana that's available for recreational use in Western New York is cut or laced with something else. So we get this information from the Buffalo DEA, and what they report to us is that drug dealers are putting either some type of filler in with the marijuana so that they can spread their supply out further and make more money off of it, or more common recently, they are lacing marijuana with other drugs so that people get hooked on a product that provides a more intense high. They keep coming back to that drug dealer for the better high that guarantees the drug dealer income. 90% of it is in that situation. Now, when I stand up in front of a classroom and I share that with high school juniors or seniors, they all sit there and they roll their eyes at me because I'm the drug counselor at the front of the room telling them how bad their pot is. When one of our kids gets up and shares their story and they talk about an experience where they bought bad marijuana, they listen to every word and they believe every word. And it demonstrates the importance of that peer-to-peer interaction. We are seeing perception of risk with marijuana go down among teenagers. And I think personally that that has a lot to do with the messaging that they're hearing around medicinal marijuana. They're hearing about marijuana being prescribed for glaucoma and seizures and all kinds of other medical issues. And it's working for a lot of those medical issues. But what nobody's explaining to the public is that the marijuana that's used for medicinal purposes is nothing like the marijuana that's used for recreational purposes. In medicinal products, most of the THC has been removed. So you're not going to get high from it the same way you're going to get high from something that you buy out on the street corner. And so we're seeing kids' perception of risk with marijuana going down, when in all reality it should be going up, because such a high percentage of this product is cut or laced with something else. Now, rewind to 12 or 15 years ago. We dealt with a group of teenagers who were under the impression that prescription drugs were safer than street drugs because they were prescribed by doctors. Prescription drugs were safer than street drugs because they knew if they took a Lorotab or a hydrocodone, there was no chance of it being cut or laced with another substance. And you fast forward back to today, and we are in the midst of the worst opiate epidemic we've ever dealt with. What kids don't realize about prescription medications is that they cannot be used recreationally the way they might dabble a little bit with alcohol or marijuana. There are many teenagers who go out on Friday or Saturday night, and they have a little bit to drink, or they smoke a little bit of marijuana, and guess what? They get up on Monday morning, they come to school, they do what they have to do, and they get through life, and they never really face any severe consequences. They are able to use those substances socially. If they try to do the same with prescription drugs, that will not happen. If they use a bunch of painkillers on the weekend, and let's say they do that for maybe 3 or 4 weekends in a row, eventually they're going to wake up on Monday morning, and they're going to be in withdrawal. And if nobody has ever explained withdrawal from an opiate or from a painkiller to you, it's described as the worst flu you could ever remember having in your life, multiplied by 1,000. You have hot and cold sweats, you're throwing up, you have diarrhea, you feel like you have bugs crawling under your skin, and no matter what you do, you can't get rid of that creepy kind of crawly feeling. You're freezing cold and you want to stand under the hot shower just to warm up, but the touch of the water hitting your skin will be unbearably painful. And all these symptoms happen at the very same time, and they could last upwards of 5, 6, 7, 8 days. And the only way to make yourself feel better if you're experiencing this withdrawal is to take more opiates. And so very, very quickly, we see teenagers go from using these pills to experience the high that initially comes with them to using them just to feel normal enough to be able to get up and function through the day. And a very, very vicious cycle begins. And they get to a point where they need more and more of these pills to meet the tolerance that they're building for the opiates. And these pills are very, very costly on the street. And very, very quickly, they get to a point where they can't afford these pills. So what do? They make the progression into heroin. because if you're not aware, prescription painkillers and heroin are essentially one and the same thing. Pills are made in a lab by a chemist. Heroin comes from the opiate plant. But when you look at the two substances under a microscope, they are nearly identical to one another in chemical structure. So they provide a very, very similar experience for the body. Heroin, however, is still that awful stigmatized drug that every kid in Western New York swears up and down they're never going to use. But it's super, super cheap in Western New York right now. And so they get to a point where, you know, they're willing to throw the stigma out the window and break that promise that they made to themselves and make the progression into the heroin. I also want to spend a minute talking to you about some substances that you may not be quite so familiar with. But I'm going to break this down for you guys a little bit more. You've heard me talk a lot about painkillers. And from the perspective of teenagers, painkillers are by far and large the most common type of prescription drug to be abused. However, don't forget about ADD and ADHD medications. Don't forget about anti-anxiety drugs. Don't forget about antidepressant pills, because they are all very popular with kids as well. Particularly right now, Xanax is very popular. Xanax is a benzodiazepine. And what's scary about benzos is that when you withdraw from those, they can send you into a state of seizures that you will not come out of. Kids are also mixing these pills with alcohol, which further worsens the effects of these symptoms on them. When they use prescription drugs, they crush them up into a powder form and they snort the powder. That is the most common way to get high with a pill. It causes a very bitter tasting post-nasal drip. Think about if you've ever taken like an uncoated Tylenol and it takes you too long to grab a glass of water, or if you've ever accidentally chewed a pill that was supposed to be swallowed, you'll never make that mistake again because it's real bitter tasting. That's what the post-nasal drip tastes like. So it suppresses their appetite. They constantly have a sniffly and a runny nose, but they're high within minutes of snorting that powder. And so they're willing to deal with the discomfort that comes with that. The major difference with the prescription drug abuse is that they will function very normal while they're high. If a kid comes to school drunk, you know it. They're stumbling over, they're slurring their speech, their eyes are glassy and red. If they come to school high, you know that too. You can smell the marijuana from a mile away. If you can't smell the marijuana, you can smell the bottle of perfume or cologne that they've dumped on themselves to mask the smell. Their eyes are all red, and you know they're heading to a refrigerator or to their locker for a snack because they've got the munchies. But when they come to school high on pills, there's none of that. They function very normal. And a lot of kids will report that when they're using pills, they blow a couple before they come to school in the morning, that they get through the first half of the day just fine. Blow a couple more around lunchtime, they get through the second half of the day. They might even blow a couple more after the school day ends. They will go perform on the sports field. They will go be involved in a club or activity. They will go work a part-time job, and they will function through all of those things exactly as they should. When you begin to notice a problem is when they have gone many, many hours without these pills in their system. And for some of these kids, that starts to happen around 8 or 9 o'clock at night, when they're home on the couch watching TV or finishing up their homework, and all of a sudden they say to their parents, gee, I'm not feeling good. My body's sore and achy, I'm nauseous, I got the hot and cold sweats. I'm gonna go up to bed a little early tonight and catch a little extra sleep. And they go to their room, they close the door, they blow a couple more pills. That allows them to sleep through the night, and the vicious cycle starts all over again the next day. Because initial withdrawal symptoms are a much more mild version than what I explained to you. And so it looks just like the flu, and it's so easy for these kids to pass it off as just not feeling well. And so we have a lot of parents report that their child's substance use with pills goes on for months and months and months before some of the very subtle warning signs start to paint a picture of what's really going on. I mentioned that these pills are not nearly as easy to get as they once were. The supply of prescription drugs on the street has gone way down, and as a result, the cost has gone up. And it has become a very, very difficult habit for especially a teenager to support financially. So typically, when kids begin using painkillers, they're gonna start with like a hydrocodone or a Lortab. Hydrocodone Lortab is prescribed for every ache and pain under the sun. If you've ever sprained an ankle, if you've had a tooth pulled, if you suffer from migraine headaches, there's a very good chance you've been prescribed these pills. Hydrocodone Lortab is the number one prescribed controlled substance in the United States. And in this country, we consume 95% of the world's supply of this drug. But guess what? We only make up 7% of the world's population. So if kids save up their lunch money for a week or two, they've got enough money to get a couple of these pills to get high on the weekend. And when they begin using pills, that's all they need is a couple. They typically report when they start using these that they need to snort 2 or 3 hydrocodones or Lortabs to experience a high. The problem is within a matter of weeks, They report that they might snort 10 or 12 of these multiple times a day to feel the same thing they felt from two or three just a couple weeks before. And the reason why that is because hydrocodone Lortab is a low-grade painkiller. So it has this much Tylenol in it and only this much of that desired opiate in it. And so they need more and more pills to meet their tolerance. And they get to a point where the amount of Tylenol that they're ingesting starts to negatively impact their liver. Or more common, they get to the point where they can't snort that much powder back. If you've ever been prescribed hydrocodone or Lortab, you know what size that large white oval pill is. If you have 10 or 12 of those crushed up in front of your face, that is a massive pile of powder that you have to snort. That's when we see kids make the progression into high-grade painkillers, like OxyContin, and more recently, Opanas. Those OxyContin pills, that 80 milligram OxyContin pill, is the size of the little plug in the back end of a Bic pen. They are teeny, teeny, tiny little pills. And if you or I, with no tolerance to an opiate, were to snort one or two of those OxyContins, it very easily could kill us. No questions asked. It would send us into respiratory arrest, and that would be it. The kids on our campus, if they haven't yet made the progression into heroin, report that they are snorting four or five of those OxyContin pills a day. And the problem with that is that those pills could cost them anywhere from $80 to $100 per pill, depending on where they are in Western New York. So we're talking about a several hundred dollar a day habit that teenagers certainly cannot afford to support. And so we see them start to do things like pawn their parents' wedding rings, steal medication from their grandparents and not think twice about it, break into cars and houses, take their little brother's Xbox to the pawn shop, stand outside of Rite Aid or Walgreens and wait for the elderly to come out the door and rip their prescriptions out of their hand that they just filled at the pharmacy counter. These are all things kids on our campus have done. And again, I remind you, the kids that we're treating are good kids. They're just caught up in an absolutely awful thing, and they are so desperate to avoid that god-awful withdrawal that comes with all of this, that these are the steps that they take. That's when we see them make the progression into heroin. And I'm not gonna spend a ton of time talking to you guys about heroin because Cheryl is gonna do a fantastic job covering the heroin epidemic that we have here. And I wanna talk to you about some other substances in the few minutes that I have left. But we are seeing kids use heroin. Heroin right now is going for $5 or $10 a hit, and a hit of heroin is equivalent to one of those 80 or 100 milligram pills. So when you compare $5 or $10 a hit to $80 or $100 per pill, I don't care how stigmatized that drug is. People are going to make that progression because it's so much more affordable. Heroin is also available in a powder form, so it can be snorted the very same way these kids are already accustomed to snorting the pills. Just to give you an idea of this, 90% of the patients that we treat on the Renaissance campus come into treatment with a prescription drug addiction. 70% of our patients are IV heroin addicted. That is an alarmingly high number of good kids who are caught up in an absolutely awful epidemic. And again, Cheryl's going to cover that more for you guys in a minute. How many of you have heard of dabbing or dabs or wax? Okay. If you're not familiar, dabbing is the process of extracting THC oil from marijuana and smoking that oil in its purest form. Now, when this first became popular, teenagers were using butane gas to extract the THC oil from the marijuana, which was very, very dangerous, highly flammable. Now they've come to realize that they can do this with any type of a heat source. So they can use a hair straightener or a blow dryer to heat up their marijuana. They can put it in a double boiler pot on the stove. We just had kids last week tell us that they are going online and they are buying like desktop-sized sheet metal presses, and they're putting the marijuana between two sheets of wax paper. They're pressing the weight down on the marijuana that forces the oil out of the plant, and then they're using the oil. So they are always coming up with a new way to do this. But basically what happens is you extract the oil from the marijuana, and depending on how much oxygen gets to that oil will determine which type of substance is created. This is known as wax on this far side close to me. You can see why. It looks just like earwax. It's thick, it's sticky, it's gross looking. The other product that you see is known as shatter. It's an amber colored sheet of glass that you break into teeny tiny little pieces. You put a tiny little dab of that wax, which is why it's referred to as dabbing, or a tiny little piece of that shatter into an e-cigarette or a vaporizer. And that device will heat that substance back up into a vapable form, and you vape the substance. Now, again, parents tell me every day, if my kid was smoking marijuana, I would totally know it because I would smell it. Well, if they're dabbing, you're probably not going to smell it. It has very little to no marijuana odor. And dabs can be as little as 5 times more potent than regular marijuana to as much as 90 times more potent than regular marijuana. And kids love this stuff because they know they're not going to get caught with it. The problem with it is that you develop such a tolerance to THC that our kids report that they are dabbing every hour of the day and they're still not maintaining a high. And so what do we see them do then? We see them progress into substances that provide a longer window of being under the influence, and you know they're moving up the chain into these physically addicting substances. This is by far and large the most common thing we see teenagers do in the experimental phase of drug use. More than anything else, they absolutely love to dab. Love it. Another substance that's very, very popular with teenagers is a drug known as Molly. You may have heard of Molly before. You may have heard of Molly referenced as a pure form of MDMA or a pure form of ecstasy. And when it first became popular in Western New York, that's exactly what it was. It was a pure form of MDMA or ecstasy. Now, 85% of it is made synthetically. Molly's popular because it affects the senses. So when kids go to a concert and they're high on Molly, the lights look 10 times cooler. The music sounds 10 times better. The problem is Molly also causes the body to overheat very, very rapidly. And people tend to dehydrate and pass out as a result. So this drug is really, really popular for kids when they go to these types of music venues. The problem is when you wake up the next day and you don't have Molly in your system anymore, you have a hangover times a million. Plus your emotions are so severely impacted that you are so depressed that you couldn't get out of bed if your life depended on it. And so kids use more Molly and they become addicted to it. In the pure form, Molly comes in these fun colored tablets that look just like ecstasy. In the synthetic form, it comes in that capsule. And you can put that capsule in somebody's drink. You can bake it into food. You can go to Tops or Wegmans and buy a bottle of vegetable glycerin. That vegetable glycerin will liquefy that powder, and then you can put it into an e-cigarette or a vaporizer, and you can vape this drug. This drug is also highly, highly referenced in the music that our kids listen to. Very, very popular. The last drug I'm going to talk to you guys about is something that I haven't presented on in a long time, but recently we have started to hear about school districts having a problem with it. And that is a substance called lean or purple drink or Scizerp. Basically what it is a combination of cough syrup, and that cough syrup is preferred to have codeine in it, alcohol, soda, and candy, all mixed together in a cup. And when you use this substance, it causes a euphoria and then a sedative state. And so it's known as lean because when people are high on it, they're literally like leaning over because they're so sedated. This substance was super, super popular in the 1990s down south. And, you know, several years ago we heard about little pockets of it here in Western New York, and then it went away for a while, and as I mentioned just recently, we've began to hear about it again. It is also highly referenced in the music that kids listen to. And several rappers have actually passed away from an overdose on this substance. This is what it looks like. It's purple. It looks kind of just like Grape Crush. And it's very, very difficult to detect because it looks just like regular soda pop. So my last slide, what can you do if you're concerned about a student, and what can you encourage parents to do? This is more for the education side of what you can do. Stay educated about the topic. Again, if you think your district would be supportive of a presentation like this, please, please, please bring us in. They will get this plus the parent perspective, as I mentioned. It'll take us about an hour to do all of that. Speak to your students in a non-judgmental tone if they come to you with concerns about their drug problem. If you're seeing something happening, you have to say something. You have to say something to your building administrators. Somebody needs to get in touch with these kids' parents and let them know that this is happening. And these are just some of the suggestions that we give to parents. We talk a lot about consequences with parents. We encourage parents to hold their ground when they threaten consequences. The worst thing a parent can do is threaten a consequence and then not follow through on it. We encourage home drug testing. If you're going to talk to parents about doing home drug testing, the home drug test needs to be done randomly and it needs to be observed. If they're not going to do those two things, they shouldn't even bother giving the test because it's probably not going to be accurate. We encourage the safe disposal of prescription drugs. We have permanent drop boxes all over Erie and Niagara County where you can safely get rid of your controlled substances. And last but not least, please don't hesitate to reach out for us for support. If at any point you are dealing with a student who is struggling with a substance abuse problem, we don't expect you guys to be able to figure that out. All we want you to do is call us and we'll help you figure it out. So pull out your phone, take a picture of this, jot it down if you have to, and call us. Please, 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 whether it's for support in your school or whether it's support for a particular family that you are assisting. I'm out of time, so I'm going to turn it back over to Betty, who's going to turn it over to Cheryl, and you guys will learn all about the opiate and heroin epidemic that we're dealing with. If anybody has any questions, I'll move toward the back, and you can just step up quick and ask me a question while we switch gears here.
Jess, are you going to be here for yours?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll stay.
Because then if anybody needs anything, they can certainly reach out to you. Great, great, great presentation. We are going to note Cheryl Moore's presentation on. Cheryl is a medical care assistant from the Erie County Health Department, and a wealth of knowledge that she will share with us. And Cheryl, if you want to introduce your...
Well, welcome, folks. Thanks for that. Can everybody hear me? Okay, it's not happening in my world. So that being said, this is Captain Madden from the Buffalo Police Department. We do this kind of training all over Western New York. We've been doing it for about 2.5 years now. We thought we would do this a few times for local law enforcement when this epidemic first started. And I think we see each other more than our families now. Let me get my presentation up and we'll get going here. So this is opiate overdose prevention training, as I said, and really what we do talk about here is the heroin epidemic in Western New York. And it's not just heroin, it's opiate. So I think just starting out, a couple things you want to bring to mind here. Number one, no one woke up one day and said, I think I'll be an opiate addict. They didn't do that. Once they did become addicted, though, to these drugs, it's a lifelong chronic disease. I heard Jess talking about a lot of different issues here with young people. This isn't just young people. But addiction is a disease of the young. When people are younger, they can become addicted quicker. The brains are developing. You know, think about these things. There's all these different stuff. Pat and I, as I said, have been doing this training. Our bosses have let us have really pretty much free reign to get out in the community. We've trained almost 14,000 people now. The stigma, as Jess talked about, huge stigma to this addiction. Your families and friends, they're not going to talk about it. And they need to talk about it. They can hear me fine. They need to talk about it, folks. They have to. Because when you don't talk about it, you die. Is my clicker not working?
No.
Oh, look at that. Good. We train also when we do this, just so you're aware, with Horizon Health Services and Evergreen Health Services. These are some of our biggest treatment agencies in Western New York. They treat everyone. Young folks have a unique niche with kids escaping drugs and with Renaissance Campus. Whole different ball of wax there. But young folks eventually do grow up and become us. The other thing is, looking around here, you cannot anticipate who is addicted to opiates today. It's not what television portrayed in movies. It's not what, you know, when I heard that description of, oh, the dirty person. It's not what Pat will tell you, you know, when people come into the city looking to buy drugs historically. Well, it's totally different, completely different. So we'll tell you a whole lot about this stuff. This is why we're here. I'm from the health department, as I said. We're data geeks. Like, that's what we do. We count numbers. You're going to learn signs and symptoms of an overdose, about the Good Samaritan law. Please ask Captain Mann's questions about this when he talks about it. This is critical for young people. This is about calling for help. This is about keeping people alive. You're going to learn about ESAP and SEP. In your packages of stuff, you have a listing in there. There's a sheet. It has places all over Western New York where you can get rid of old medications and old needles. That's under the ESAP program. SEP is about syringe access and disposal. Both of them are. Because today, this is about IV drug use. People say, I'm not going to be an IV drug user. But when you are really, really sick in that withdrawal stage, that's the most direct route to make sick go away. So eventually it does happen. And when this does happen, what we're learning, we have number one, oh my gosh, we have hepatitis C, the numbers like I haven't seen and I cannot believe. And it's under 30. People under 30 in two stages of hepatitis C in Erie County. We haven't seen this since about 09. Now, hepatitis C was the disease of, you know, we said baby boomers. Not anymore. The other part is HIV. HIV, initially, many years ago, about a third of people who became infected with HIV got it through sharing needles. We got that number down to like 6% by a lot of education, a lot of don't do that. Guess what? Everybody and their brother sharing needles again, pretty indiscriminately. Those numbers are going to go up. These are lifelong diseases. Then you're going to learn about Narcan, Naloxone, to reverse an overdose. This is the only thing that reverses an overdose. And I appreciate you all being here because we did have a reversal in one of our suburban schools last week.
Some do, some don't.
And I'll tell you about that. All of your districts should have policies at this point. State Ed has put policies out there. If your district doesn't want to implement them full bore like that, they can come under the county's policies. We can provide Narcan to you in training. Pat and I have been out in multiple school districts doing training. I know Horizons has been also to get their programs up and running. There's different things in place there. It's just first aid. You know, we all have AEDs, everybody's learning CPR. This is just another tool for first aid. So people need to learn this. But there are policies, it is legal. You know, there's all these questions by people, but it's there, it's available. Yeah.
Did you say State Ed says every district should have a policy?
Yeah, at this point, there's a link for it. And actually I can send it out to Betty and she can send it to all of you. They've pre-developed, you know, templates of policies and procedures, training. You can just go in and plug in your information, bring it to the school board and adopt it. Yes. Well, I'll be honest with you, school boards are becoming much more amenable here. I'm going to tell you right up front. Because this epidemic is affecting everyone. Because it's affecting everyone. And it has to hit home. We've noticed that people make changes too. And I'll tell you, there's nowhere it hasn't hit home. So we're going to show you a lot. We'll show you some data now. So, we looked at this from the health department. Anybody that dies in Erie County, this is Erie County specific data. We have a medical examiner's office. So anyone that dies and we don't know why goes to a medical examiner's office, get an autopsy toxicology screen done. In 2014, it took us till, this is bad, September of 2015 to clear all the bodies from 2014. And that's when we saw that little blip there. Went up to 127 people that died from opioid overdose. That was kind of a big blip. You know, it's 25% higher if you look at that. They've been stable behind that. Why did that take so long? We didn't have tests for the drugs that were out there. So the toxicology experience, they took forever because we hadn't developed tests to do on the body fluids to figure out what killed people. So there's all these conflicting things that were out there. 2014 is also the year a law called MyStop went into place. Has anyone heard that term, MyStop? This is going to explain the transition from prescription drugs to street drugs. This is what happened. This is what initiated it. So I'll tell you about that. But that day, we had 127 deaths due to opioid overdoses. 2015, on that same day, we already had 108. So moving forward, this is residents at time of death from 2014. There's not a town or a village, if you look here, that wasn't affected. Now, because we started to look deeper, we're like, what on earth is going on out there? This is totally, from my perspective in public health, not what we expected at all. This was like, holy macaroni, what is going on out there? So we started looking deeper and we started monitoring more so. Not listening. Okay, so this is what folks died from. This is 2014. Other opioids, that's prescription drugs. Heroin, from poppy. Fentanyl, that is not from the drugstore. We're not talking the fentanyl patch, the duragesic patch. This is something different. Pat's going to tell you a lot about it. This is the year ISTOP went in place. ISTOP is a New York State-specific prescription monitoring program designed to stop the flow of crazy amounts of prescription drugs. We just told you about numbers. United States, 5% of the world's population, 80% of the world's OxyContin, 90% of the world's opiate scripts overall. That's just crazy. Crazy. We had a huge problem before 2014. I could go to my primary, I could go to my dentist, I could go to my OB, I could go to my, my foot doctor, I could go to the emergency room, I could go to my friend's doctor, literally, complain about that. I could get strips. Remember the old triple strips? For those opiate strips. And if I had really good health insurance, my ridiculous health insurance would pay for them all. I take it all to the drugstore and think, yeah, great health insurance. Just pay your copay. Now, after 2014, what happened? Real-time live system. This limited how much could be prescribed. Because now, when I go to my primary, at my visit, she looks me up in an internet-based system. It's like, okay, you haven't had your, 28 days. Now I'm going to electronically send a prescription to the drugstore. Did you hear two different things here? No more paper. So diversion's like out the window. And she's looking me up in this real-time system. Now if I try all these other docs, they gotta look in the same system. They're like, oh, hell no. Had one 10 minutes ago. Get out. Go away. Because people had a lot of scripts. Now, if something gets through, I get to the pharmacy, he looks me up in that same system. It's like, okay, you haven't had your Lortab filled in 28 days. Now let's look at how you're going to pay for it. See the difference? What happened here? But at this point, there's still a lot of prescription drugs on the street. They were fairly reasonable. Anything you get at the drugstore, you can get on the street. 2015 is going to change drastically. So it was a very male disease in 2014, a very white disease, average age of death, 40-year-old white suburban male. We keep tracking this. This was January of 2016. This year, we kept looking at these numbers. There was 198 deaths due to opioid overdoses. The total number for 2015, for the 2015 year, was 256. So it doubled from 2014. But the critical part here is, see that 127? 62 is prescription drugs, about half. 29 is fentanyl, about a quarter. Look at 2015. 58 is prescription drugs. This is the whole year after I stopped in place. Remember that limit? But people, when you're addicted to opiates, this isn't about getting high and having a party, it's about functioning. It's about making the sick stay away so you can function. So it doesn't matter if it comes from the drug dealer or the drug store. You can see it there on those death numbers. Our 256, and it's not getting better. So this is the breakdown in 2015. If you look at it, it's not any different than 2014. Same basic breakdown. Every town, every village. Does everybody watch local news around here, like 247, those kind of news stations? Mm-hmm. What do you know about this area, City of Buffalo?
I've been with Buffalo Police Department 31 years. Where do you think our big problem in the city is? Northeast, southwest. Knowing the city, what you know of the city? We got west, we have north, it's South Buffalo. South Buffalo is our biggest problem, followed by North Buffalo, followed by the west side. Most of our overdoses on the west side are suburban residents. A lot of things that misconceptions, stereotypes. East side's our least problem. For years, traditionally, was if you wanted weed, you went to the east side. If you wanted heroin, you went to the west side. Still kind of follows that, but our big problem is South Buffalo. A lot of reasons why. People had jobs in South Buffalo that had really good health care. A lot of union jobs out there. Maybe didn't make killing and pay, but you got a lot of good benefits. One of the benefits was you got good health care and you could get scripts all the time. ISOP comes in, it changes things.
Just because you take the source away, like the pills, doesn't mean the sick went away. You gotta realize that. So moving on. Come on, we can do this. The disease is changing just a little bit. It's becoming actually, it was about 20% female and about 80% male. I think it's leveling out at about 30-70 female male, which is very interesting because opioid addiction was historically male. Really male-based, really male, to confirm what the kids have seen, and that's why they think that. That's what's on television. That's what's been portrayed historically. Our last big opiate breakout here in the United States, think about it, after Vietnam. We had a lot of vets come back, addicted, a lot of post-traumatic stress, a whole lot of baggage going on. Because it was very commonplace to have opium dens in Vietnam, it's just normal. You know, so this was our last big blood community. That was mostly males in their 20s, in the early 30s. Different. So moving on, our clicker will work here. It's not listening, is it? We were at 173 deaths in 2016 on October 1st. I've left this here because when we move on to the next slide, in our disturbing world, I'm going to show you more. See, it's balancing out about a third female. Because then we're data geeks. We like counting numbers on everything in the health department. Moving on, show you some more. This is by race. The first year is really, really white. It's leveled out. The disease is affecting all races and all ethnicities equally to our demographics of Erie County. So if the county has 7% of an Hispanic population, well, that's about how our deaths are breaking down. It's really unbelievable. What is this saying? This disease, and it is a chronic disease, folks. Once you have it for the rest of your life. In type 2 diabetes, you can own the disease, or it can own you. This disease is an equal opportunity employer. It doesn't care who you are, what you look like, where you live. Doesn't care. Really doesn't care. So this is that breakdown of ages. Once again, this is for the 256 people in 2015. It's from 16 to 83 years of age. Average age of death, 38-year-old, once again, white suburban man. Think about who this is dying from opioid overdoses. I mean, think about who that person is, that individual. I know we're talking a lot about the shiz, but who is this? That's Dan. That's the head of household. That's what we're talking about today. So you want to talk about stress? Only natural. So we kept looking, and this is to show you other opioids, and this is where you're going to see that transition from I-STAT. Just because we took the source away, I'm going to say over and over, doesn't mean we took the disease away. We have heroin, we have synthetic heroin, and we made like heroin on steroids. We are chemists extraordinaire around here. So about half prescription drugs, about a quarter fentanyl. Pat's going to tell you a lot about this fentanyl stuff. This is what we're putting heroin with. He's going to tell you quite a bit. Want to go to the next one? Look at this. Look at 2015. It's only about a quarter of prescription drugs. But look at that fentanyl number. 43%. Heroin about 12%, and then heroin and fentanyl. Look at 2016. And this is with 173 deaths. We are up to 223 confirmed now. There's about 90-some bodies awaiting that are presumed due to opiate overdoses. We're waiting back the results on their tox screens. It was a big hit this past weekend. It was like 11 or 12 folks' bodies came in that were presuming. Just, you don't know. You just don't know. But look at that, that fentanyl. Okay.
All right, here's the deal with the fentanyl. Cheryl talked about it. It's going to be a huge problem in this area. We know the fentanyl comes from out of Mexico through the drug cartels. It's not the patch that everybody's used to. It's high-grade, high-purity that they're mixing with the heroin. The heroin on the street right now is probably about 70% pure. It used to be around 40%. They've increased that. This fentanyl is real high-grade, real high-purity. Get your grains of salt. Take 1 to 3 grains of salt and put it on a table in front of you. Could you even see 1 to 3 grains of salt? It's so small. That comparable amount of fentanyl will cause a fatal overdose in an opioid user. So they're mixing this with the heroin. People are going to the heroin, and you know, Jessica had talked about that before, why they're going to heroin. I-STOP comes in, the pills aren't available. Pills are still out there, but you're going to pay for it. She gave you some prices, and that's probably a current price of what's going on around here. So if you have high tolerance and you are using, you know, opioids at a high rate, what are you going to be able to afford? You don't have a job, you've totally alienated yourself from your family, you're going to go to the heroin. Heroin, 5, 6, maybe 10 bucks a bag, depending on how much you have. What we're seeing because of that is the change in who our drug dealers are. We're finding that a lot of our drug dealers are users. They need 4 or 5 bags of heroin to get through the day. They're going to buy 10 because they can get it cheaper. We're seeing this a lot more with our suburban and urban areas where they'll buy the 10, they'll take what they need, and they'll sell the rest and jack the price up a little bit. They're just covering their costs. Another thing that I think, you know, that Jess showed you up here was who our typical user is. It's not that pitcher. It's, you know, it's the person that you're sitting next to at Little League. So your neighbor, it's a person who has a job, they're paying their bills, you know, they're dealing with their kids, they've got a problem. And Jessica talked about, you know, the youth part of it, you know, we're talking about the overall part of it. One of the things that we've seen is, thanks to the reporting, some of the changes of how things have happened. Cheryl's tracked this and she's seen a really high incident, or a really high percentage increase in what time our overdoses are. We're seeing a lot of overdoses between 4 and 8 in the morning and 4 and 8 in the afternoon. What are most people doing during that night? Think about what are you doing during that time, Monday through Friday, between 4. You're either sleeping or where are you going? You're driving, you're going to work. You're doing the same thing. You stop and get your cup of Hortons in the morning because you can't start the day without Hortons. They're getting something else. They got to get through the day. The getting high part's gone. This is they're just trying to feel normal. It's not working in a while. Now, the one time somebody told me that, you know, think of the worst hangover you ever had in your life. They wake up like that every morning 100 times that. That's just how they feel when they wake up. They're trying to feel like everyone else. So, you know, this fentanyl is real bad. We don't know what's out on the street anymore. Now, they take the fentanyl and they mix it with the heroin. It's not a compounding pharmacy where everything's distributed equally. They dump the heroin in a bowl, they dump the fentanyl in the bowl, and they cut whatever cutting agent they're throwing into the bowl. Popular cutting agents are baby powder, baby formula, drywall plaster, you know, the dry stuff, any of that stuff, they're mixing it up. Taking a stick and mixing it. I always kind of chuckle at myself when the media says there's a bad batch of heroin on the street. I've been doing this 31 years. I've never seen a good batch of heroin on the street. So,
it's very scary, too, to see that. Pat and I talked about that yesterday because one of the local police chiefs came out and said that. And I'm like, oh, geez, people are just going to be out there going, where is that?
Yeah.
Because they're so sick, folks. And if you have something that's more potent, you got to buy less. It costs you less. This is about maintenance. Think about alcoholism. Someone who's in that, and it's something that we know as a society, you got a lot of functional alcoholics. We'll lift before work in the morning, stop shaking, get through work, stop the barber shot on the way home. This is, it is functional, but we're, same thing. That's what we're seeing a lot of. The other deaths we're seeing a lot of that are changing, over 40. Remember I showed you that? Over 40s. Think about who that is. I mean, I think about it. I'm in healthcare. My first degree was in social work, my next degree was in nursing, they'll do something else. But when I was working in nursing, I didn't know a nurse that didn't have back injury. Didn't know one. There was before electronic boiler lifts and all that stuff. We transferred people, we turned people, this is what we did. People were on a lot of medications. First responders, they get a lot of accidents, they get hurt, they transfer, but they don't think about this. Construction, holy macaroni, there are tons of pills. Pat and I were at Ford yesterday. Ford Motor Company has adopted this nationally, what we're doing here, because they see it as an issue. So, I mean, this is quite interesting. What's happening now is not good.
This has changed kind of our whole workload. In law enforcement, we never did this sort of stuff before. You got to remember, we don't get dispatched at first aid calls. Last year, we used Narcan 250 times on people. This year, we're hitting about 500. We're not getting dispatched at first aid calls. This is what we get flagged down. This is what we come across. Some of the officers are getting frustrated when you're narcaning the same person two and three times in one day. They're still doing it. They're still coming in to me and getting more Narcan kits, and they're still using it. Our average Narcan use is 3 to 4 doses on one person to bring them out of an overdose. We've had higher numbers than that, but that seems to be what our average is. A lot of that's because of the purity of the drugs that are on the street in this area.
Nobody, we're going to show you some pictures here, so we'll look through there. So, that's like I said, our dates, to date, that's where we are. We're probably going to hit about 350 this year. At the beginning of the year in Erie County, we were trying to get about 12 to 14 deaths a week. A few weeks ago, it was down to 5 and 7, we're back up again. We had estimated these things. There's no estimate. I mean, I keep saying that to my folks at work, like, stop getting excited. It's going to happen. I know it. I'm jinxing myself. So, numbers, we track them. We try to be on top of this. Why do we do this? To try to get education out, to work with agencies like Kids Escaping Drugs. The average age, and we've done surveys on the street, we asked people. We asked 100 people. We've done this twice now. We're doing it right now. 2012 and 2015, interviewed 100 people on the street. We asked them where they got their first opiate, what it was, all these questions. So here it is, 100 out of 100. First opiate, a prescription drug prescribed to them by a provider for something. These were the reasons why. Teeth, sports injuries, Big sports injuries, huge. And then the other, like car accidents, things like that, like games, things like that when you got hurt. We asked them how old they were. Anyone want to guess key ages? 12 and 14. Those were consistent. Consistent. Now, when you think about it, teeth, nobody needs 90 Vicodin to get your tooth out. No. Yeah, exactly. Some ibuprofen, beautiful drug. Now, this is very typical what we did. 90 Vicodin, 3 a day, that's how that's ordered. That's 30 days worth. How long does it take you to become addicted? Regular use. Could be. We think maybe from long-term studies, hear my words, we think maybe. From long-term studies, it's like 2.5 to 3 weeks is the tipping point if you're genetically predisposed. So if you give somebody of 30 days worth, that's like freaking Russian roulette on who's becoming physically addicted or not. So there's all these bad things. All these bad things happen. The other end of the world, too, when someone gets hurt at work, they go to a comp doc. We tend to not fix underlying problems. We tend to throw a lot of things. Worked with a lot of folks, and we worked with different people understanding pain. They're like, oh, I can't get my oxycodone. It changes. I'm like, well, what are you taking it for? What hurt my back 23 years ago? Okay, do we miss something here? 23 years ago, you're still thinking, you know, like, that should be healed. So, you know, it's all these things that have happened. So moving on, we talked about motor vehicle accidents. We'll skip past them. CDC's dragged this forever and ever. Keep doing it, and we just don't pay attention. So when you leave here, you'll be trained overdose responders, and these are your responsibilities. Your primary responsibility is call 911. If you do nothing else, call 911, okay? Gotta do it. And when you call, you gotta tell them it's an overdose and you need Narcan. And I'm telling you this because he told you how much they use it. If you're in the city of Buffalo and you're in South Buffalo, you want a car that went and got more at the station house, for Christ's sake. If you're in the suburban or rural areas, it's mostly volunteer driven. You gotta tell them what you need. I will tell you, I've trained, Pat and I have trained most of the fire departments in Western New York. The volunteers, and they do carry it and they use it. There's only three police departments that don't. Other than that, all the rest do. So the three that don't are Seneca, Town of Tonawanda, and Lackawanna.
She said it, I didn't go. Don't tell Batman said it.
So, if you do use your kits, I need you to report. I want you to be aware of what you're getting into. What's out there? I want you to report. I want you to tell us what you're doing. Because the kits, we do have some kits to distribute with you. There's been a big recall, but I'm also going to give you options on how to get Narcan. There's a shared access order process in New York State. You can go to any drugstore without a prescription. Say, I want to buy Narcan, and actually charge it back to your health insurance. I mean, that's it, yeah.
Is there a rationale why those three departments don't carry it?
Well, Town of Tonawanda, it's in a union issue right now. I've been through that. Because they have paramedics there. So they're like back and forth, like, it's my job, it's my job. So hopefully they'll figure that one out. Okay. I will say Buffalo figured that one out. We just ignored the union issue and moved forward.
And we were one of the first.
They were.
For once, we did something.
We did something right. West Seneca, it's their choice. And Lackawanna claims that fire is enough. So that's the rationale.
In the city of Buffalo, we have the police department and the fire department and the ambulance service. The fire department's doubling what we do. Half the time they're running out of Narcan kits. We pull up, you know, we get calls, it says fire, we pull up and the firemen are there already. Do you have a kit? And we're just handing kits off to them. That's how much they're using it.
I'll tell you, this has developed different relationships. I've never worked with local law, but I'm a public health for Christ's sake. You know, this has learned, we've learned so much. But this came from the DEA, the head of the DEA out of Down. And they came out and they said, you can't arrest your way out of this out of Down. Got to treat your way out of here. We had to think differently on what was going on. I brought a lot of literature with me today. I left it out there for you. Please take it for your schools when you leave. In Erie County, there's a very active opiate epidemic task force. There's a lot of support materials. There's new ways to get into treatment. It's all out there. This is about the hotline. Take it back to your schools. Leave it for people. Yeah.
So if the same person getting treated 3, 4, 5, 6 times.
Okay.
That's solving the problem, though, correct?
No, but it's a disease. So it's no different than a diabetic that
right,
has a diabetic reaction.
Down the road, you say, okay, you've been charged so many times, you're going into rehab, or
it, the
I
mean, way
I
it
like
works,
there's
and I understand,
and everything like that, but it's just
the way it works with addiction, though. And think about alcoholism once again. If you have a family member or friend and they are an alcoholic, do they ever quit drinking because you told them to? Think about it. Do they ever, even though they get a lot of pressure from family and friends and workplaces? Does that make them quit drinking? No. It's the same thing. This kind of addiction, this drug, it hijacks your brain. There's nothing rational, there's nothing logical. And I'm glad you asked that, because this is addiction. Dust them off and send them back. Hopefully it's gonna stick. You know, one of these times it might stick, and that's what we're talking about here. This is addiction. People will be sober and clean for a long time, and something will happen. They'll tell you. They'll tell you, I knew intellectually I was supposed to go over here, and something happened, and I just went over here. Steals your brain. It's very frustrating, and I understand. That's why I can't say enough to our police. Yeah.
Can you share the visual, and maybe you're going to do that?
The net?
About the hills and the valleys in your brain.
Yeah, we're going to do that.
Okay.
Yeah. So, moving forward.
There's some history here. Heroin's been around forever. Tied to the Bear Company, I want you to be aware of this. That's where it came from. That's when government stepped in 1914, here's the Narcotics Act. Previous to that, it was like, yeah, that egg has some heroin, yeah, the baby has some heroin, your toe has, your anus has some heroin. That was like snake oil. That's what it was, that's where they stepped in. And on the other end, as Pat brought up yesterday, if you're kind of tired, have some Coca-Cola. It had cocaine in it then. That's where this Narcotics Act came from. That's when government stepped in. Last time government stepped in. Government is stepping in now. We've regulated prescribing. You know, we had to do this. We had to stop it. I stopped. We had to stop it. This is crazy. So, keep going. This is local, to show you what's going on locally. This is what heroin and fentanyl look like. Those are bundles of bags. When we talk about those bags of heroin, that's 10 of them. I'll show you the next slide. This is local. This is our first discovery of fentanyl here in Western New York. First discovery probably in this whole big friggin' mess.
Not only do you see suitcases, you see kilos in front of it. Two officers in A district got called to a domestic call. They get their two sisters fighting. One sister had come out from out of town with her boyfriend with her two pieces of luggage. They're staying in the guest room, throws it under the bed. The woman who lives there, her two little girls, opened up the cases, were playing with the kilos that came out of the bedroom. One bag was filled with kilos of heroin, the other one was kilos of fentanyl. It's the first time we had really seen it. The officers make the arrest, they submit it to the Erie County Crime Lab. Crime Lab immediately comes back with, okay, we can identify one suitcase as heroin, the other one we have no idea what it is. Drug cartels were smart. They made this stuff and they removed like one hydrogen atom to make it just where it wasn't detectable. This stuff's a lot stronger than the heroin. The fentanyl is about a 10% of the cost of heroin, which is great for mixing it. But we didn't know what it was. It's to the point now that this stuff's so dangerous. I told you the 1 to 3 grains of salt. Dr. Simich at the Erie County Crime Lab got a hold of Cheryl to have her come over and train his employees. His big fear was this stuff goes airborne. That small amount. So the Erie County Crime Lab techs now are all trained in Narcan and they have stashes around there. We're training our canine officers how to Narcan our canine dogs. What do canine dogs do? Sniff for drugs. We have too much time and money invested in our dogs yet to lose them. Hartford, Connecticut police about a month ago had a raid. They hit the house, the drugs went airborne, and they had to take 11 officers to the hospital for the exposure to the drugs. We tell our officers, we sent a warning out to our officers from Erie County about a year and a half ago on dealing with drug evidence. Officers will pick things up and they'll put it right here and they'll go, oh yeah, I think this is, what are they putting it right near? Their eyes, their nose, their mouth. You got these mucous membranes. It goes airborne, we have a problem. So we had, about a year and a half ago we sent this warning out. 6 months ago the DEA sends this, basically the same warning out nationwide. We are a year and a half ahead of them. You know how we always complain we're never number one in anything? Yeah. Unfortunately, we're number one in this.
What is up here is real, folks. Those are individual bags of dope. It's dope. It's not heroin. It's not, I don't know what the hell it is. It's dope. It's some kind of opiate. But those are individual. If you see them, those, some of those are stamped Be Happy. Some have a crown. It looks like little folded up pieces of gum, like the old Trident gum, how it was folded up like that, like dentine. The material is like parchment paper. That's good. It's called glassine. It's like, you know, if you're a baker and you want parchment paper, the stuff doesn't stick to it. Why am I showing you all this? You find this stuff in school, don't be doing this. Okay? Don't pick it up. Get somebody else to do it. Probably your school resource officer. If they're going to pick something up, you're going to use gloves and you're going to use nitrile gloves, those blue ones. Okay? Just talking to you. This is just practicalities. On the next slide, I'm going to show you some, going wrong way. Going backwards here. This is evidence of drug use in the community. If you see stuff like this around your building, you see it around, this is under a throughway, this is local. But if you see stuff like this around, there's a lot of bags up here. See those bottom of the pop can? What do people do with that? Any idea? Yeah. They take their powdered stuff, put a little liquid in it, heat it up, and then they can draw it up in a syringe. The other thing you can do with that, you can use it to smoke. You can put the dry powder in, you can heat it up, the smoke comes off of it. So you see things like that. The other thing, those little pieces of paper on there, those are empty bags. Those little orange things, those are needle caps.
So there's your needle caps, there's your bags, there's your cooker, there's your containers for liquid, because they're going to use liquid. If they don't bring liquid, use any liquid they could find or produce. They'll cook it up, and that's Cheryl's shoe. This is the way off at Virginia Street. This isn't the only place like this.
This is real. And you'll see it all over. I've seen it outside of suburban mall parking lots. I've seen this everywhere. I'm really in tune to it. I look for it. I've seen it drugstore parking lots on the side quite often.
The other thing, if you look here, you see there are the syringes. They just leave them lying around.
Everywhere.
And if somebody doesn't have one and they need to use it, they'll find one.
They'll pick them up off.
Even though we have a clean needle exchange.
When you are sick, folks, it's just about taking the sick away. It's not about getting high. It's just about feeling like you need it. Now, nobody knows what's in those bags. We have a lot of overdoses. So, moving on. Let's try it. This is, for a perspective, the legal amount of heroin versus bad health.
Left side's fatal, right side's fatal, they mix it together.
So you wouldn't even see it when you think about that. Would you even see it? Think about it. I mean, we had a DEA agent that actually did a buy and they put it in their pocket and they got real sweaty and absorbed through their skin. This fentanyl is really scary stuff. So historically we said 2% of heroin users died yearly. It's probably like 20% of its opiate users. We can't say heroin because nobody knows what's in those little bags. No FDA on the street, nobody has any idea. Observing overdoses, it's not other IV drug users anymore. Who is it? Teachers? Social workers? Bosses? This is so big, we're putting together a training for community businesses so the bosses can learn to administer narcotics.
People who shop at Tossin Wagons, people who go to fast food restaurants, nobody here because this is a very healthy looking group. We'd even eat at a fast food restaurant.
This is what happens. So, I mean, this is on and on. So don't be, whatever you're not seeing what you're seeing. Like, why not do the bandits game? All I want to do is go to the bathroom. It's all I want to do is go to the bathroom. Big mistake. There's a woman, full bandits in jail. Head to toe, y'all have an expensive foot, flat out on the floor. And back with our hand. Pat and I were doing a training, about a year ago. It was interesting. We were out in East Aurora doing a training. My coworker's texted me. She's like, I'm in Wegmans. There's an overdose. I'm like, oh, in the bathroom? My first response. She's like, no, in the aisle. My middle child works in a mall. Pretty regular in dressing rooms. Pretty regular. So, I mean, just let me know these places. He calls me. He's like, I got another one. I'm a Jesus, Mary Angel. So, keep up. So, who overdoses? Well, people that have been using 5 to 10 years, very typical. You saw those deaths, those chunks 20 to 29? That's the young people, they're seeing the kids escaping drugs. That's typical. The other end is you saw those older ages. That's chunks over 40. We're starting to learn, you know, these are people that were on prescriptions forever and ever. They're just as physically addicted. It's no different. I saw one in class the other day, I didn't think about this. They're like, oh, my stash is gone. They had so many prescriptions. They've been good for the past 2 years with all these opiates they had at home. Because they've got so many because we prescribe so much. But their stash is gone now. And the guy's like, pretty open about it. He's like, yeah, I'm going to be buying that stuff on the street. I'm like, oh, geez. He knows he's sick and he knows he's got to go to work. So this is different. So, how does this happen? How do you become addicted? What happens in your brain? How do you overdose? When you take an opiate, anybody takes an opiate, I should step back. We all have opiate receptor cells, every single one of us. We're born with them. We have opiate receptor sites in our body. We also produce natural opiates. I don't know if you know that. So if you cut your finger or something, you know, and it hurts like hell, your natural opiate surge and they land on your opiate receptor sites. They're at the top of the head. And they stick there, and it makes that pain be a little better. Pleasure. You know, you're like, wow, something's great. Those endorphins flow. They land up with opiate receptor sites. You produce this. We all have these. Now, if you take an outside opiate, they land on those same sites. That's where they land to do what they're supposed to do. That's the only thing you have opiate receptor sites for opiates to land at. But if you start taking those opiates at 12, 13, 14 years of age, what's happening at that point? Brain development, frontal cortex, decision making. Think about type 2 diabetes, like I alluded to before. Type 2 diabetes occurs because your body no longer produces insulin or produces insulin that your body can't use. If you start using opiates outside of that young age, your body's not going to produce natural opiates, number one. Number one, maybe if it heals after 10, 15 years, but people usually don't live that long, so we really don't know that. The opiate user today starts much younger than they used to before, so we're learning about them longitudinally as they're around. Now, if you take outside opiates, for legal reason, I went and I had, I'm making this up, I had knee surgery, okay? Making it up. In the hospital, while I'm in the hospital with my knee surgery, they got me on the pump. You know, the infamous pumps, usually morphine. When my knee hurts, I push it. It lands on my opiate receptor sites. Think of hills and valleys in your brain like this. Top of the hill is your opiate receptor site. Down here is just where the blood's flowing all over the place. So now, landed on that opiate receptor site. Stuck on there. After about 4 hours, my knee hurts again. What the heck? I had to push the button again. What happened? I metabolized it, used it up, and I got to push more on. Now I get out of the hospital, and this is very typical with my Lortab. It says Q6PRN. Does anyone know what that means?
It means
as needed. Most public does not know as needed. They will set their alarm clock and take that every 6 hours. Okay? Now I'm taking it regularly, every 6 hours for a couple of weeks. It's not working so good anymore. Number one, I shouldn't be on it for a couple of weeks, but we've overprescribed. Not working so good anymore. What's happened, I grew more of those opiate receptor sites. Human brain, amazing. Your body is an amazing machine. So I have more slots to fill up with the same amount of opiate. That's how you develop tolerance, okay? So now I'm gonna take more to get the same effect. Now overdose, what happens? Well, that one pill isn't working so good and I'm using pills, remember? Because people overdose on pills all the time still too. One pill's not working so good. Like any good American, I'm gonna take three. Why would I take two? I'm gonna take three. So what happens is, it's in my system, it fills all the opiate receptor sites, and it fills my bloodstream. So see how much I got in there? Even those additional sites I grew are full, and my bloodstream. What you're seeing on the outside, somebody is not responsive, they're probably not breathing, or they're struggling to breathe. That's an overdose. Because as fast as they metabolize it or use it up off those opiate receptor sites, there's so much in your blood, it just keeps going back on. That's an overdose. That's when we come on you with Narcan and we can resolve it. Narcan is nothing but a placeholder. Think of a bubble. It's the easiest way I can think about it. Because people get all stressed about it. They're like, oh my God, you're gonna think about it. Like, no, no, just think of a bubble. It doesn't do anything to you unless you have a load of opiates in your body. Nothing at all. What it does when you have opiates in your body, it zeroes in on those receptor sites the same as opiates do. It likes those receptor sites even more than opiates. So it kicks it off and it's at zero step. Now it holds that place. Think of it, that's why I say think of a bubble. It doesn't make you high, it doesn't make you low. It's just a placeholder. Now, when you kick all those opiates off those receptor sites to someone that's physically addicted, you know what happens? Complete withdrawal. That what Jessica described to you, what Pat did, the real flu. And when you get a shot for, times 10. Like you're crawling on the floor. Yeah.
Are you seeing, you said, I imagine my husband and working, and they're starting to put a cuss on people before because they're seeing such an angry.
We haven't, and we actually tell officers not to. Because the thing is, think about it, you're out.
Right. All of a sudden, we've seen a response of such a fighting.
No,
we've seen a response because of cough. Think about it yourself. If you are out cold and you wake up handcuffed, there is no medical indication for that. I'd really like to know what department it is, so go and ask them.
We're out of time. We kind of tell the officers not to, because what's going to happen is when we Narcan them, we're bringing them out, and they're going right into withdrawal. They're cramping up, they're puking, they're filling their pants with everything you can possibly fill your pants with. They're telling you things that, you know, I'm going to kill you and everything else. But we haven't really seen, we've had no incidents.
And Buffalo honestly uses Narcan more than any other department combined, to be honest with you. It's what people want to believe in many things, and they're afraid. Rightfully, they're afraid. And people will tell you when they come back, realize you have made everything happen to them once that they've been trying to make not happen. Mm-hmm. So they hurt. They'll tell you to do things with your body that's really not physically possible. You're like, yeah, right, okay. Yeah, are they going to throw up? Yeah. Probably going to be projectile.
So they have to see it.
Dinner's coming out, yeah. Most of them, yeah, they will threaten. they'll drive you, like they'll do anything. They're generally kind of in a fetal position, holding their gut, throwing up, right there, where do I get myself? You know, this is kind of how it goes.
The worst we get is people telling us to do things for ourselves that we know aren't physically possible.
They will hurt. They will. You know, but they hurt. You know, they really hurt. And it's really something education-wise with law enforcement. I mean, we've really been trying to get through to them. This is a disease, folks. Nobody wants to be a drug addict. Nobody. And when we treat it that way, I mean, when you think of somebody that has cardiac arrest or a glucose incident, I mean, we wouldn't do that to somebody else. Why? What other disease would we punish somebody? Crazy.
Yeah. Line there,
public health laws have changed. 2209.
For the longest time, we couldn't force them to go to the hospital, but when we deal with them, we make them go to the hospital. Under public health law, there it's called 2209. It was originally geared towards people that were so drunk that they couldn't take care of themselves. They've since extended it to the drug overdoses. They go to the hospital, they have to stay there for 72 hours. They find some ways to get themselves out. But we make them go to the hospital because our big fear is we don't know what's there, we don't know how much they took. Mm-hmm. Okay, we Narcan them, they come to, they're great for it, I'm good, let me sign off, I'm not going in the ambulance. No, you're going in the ambulance. Our big fear is they walk away, they get a block away, and they drop again because the Narcan is pulled out and the opioid's gone back in the system. And then we have to deal with them again, and then they're in worse shape than they were before. So Narcan, at least it's a touch with the health system.
Yeah. Narcan doesn't last forever. That's what everybody said. Narcan does not last forever, and that's what Pat's talking about here. According to the manufacturer, it should last 30 to 90 minutes. Around here at West Carolina, it only lasts about 20 minutes on those receptor sites. Our drugs are way too strong. So after about 20 minutes, it wears off, and if there's still all those opiates in your bloodstream, they're going back on, right back on. And they will fall right back out again. So, I mean, there's all these pieces to this epidemic. It's scary, it's different, it's nothing anyone ever anticipated dealing with, but we are. We use a lot of Narcan because of fentanyl. And that's what we're talking about, yeah.
Is that why you had mentioned that you have to use multiple?
Yes. Yeah, Narcan is designed to use, and there's different forms of Narcan out in the community, you'll see. There's nasal, there's needles. This one here is the new product that's out. This is by Adapt Pharma. This is my favorite product, Swools. I'll give you the link. You can get it for free.
Ooh,
it's from the company.
Mm-hmm.
I gave it to Joe. He has it.
We're to the point right now where it was a while ago. The manufacturer of Narcan.
This is the other one. This is what we'll give you today. If you see this here, this one vial here, that other guy is two of these. And the fact that we use three to four of these on every reversal, I like the other product better.
But we had the manufacturer of Narcan come here to specifically talk to Sharon myself, wanting to know, they said their vice president and chief medical officer from California, wanting to know why we were using their product at four times the rate of the rest of the country.
It's fentanyl. It's fentanyl, folks. That's what it is. We're getting calls now. New York City's now starting to see fentanyl. Oh my God, they're having kids out there. I get these calls from, what should we do? I'm like, use a lot of Narcan. You know, I don't know what to say. Maybe a little blase, but we've been dealing with this for 2 years now.
And I hate to say the funny thing about that is because, you know, Cheryl has the stats. How many in the country every day?
129 deaths in the U.S. every day due to opioid overdoses. 129 every day. That's 2.5 per state every day. Think about that. Erie County, 1.5 to 2 deaths every day.
And that's just Erie County. Oh, we have that other big city in New York State who now is starting to get a problem. So we were kind of chuckling ourselves. Geez, maybe now they'll realize it's a problem and actually give some funding.
All these things, and this has all happened in the past 2 years. You saw those numbers, 2 years. Insane. Absolutely insane. Are we on a long haul? I'm from public health, like I said. This is a long run. I'm thinking this is going to be the end of my public health career. We're going to be dealing with this the next 10 years easily. We're stopping entrance into the system by prescribing practices. You can no longer get that 30 days worth as of the first of the year. If you have an acute incident, like your tooth pulled or you broke a bone, as of the first year, this is New York State law specific. If they're ordering an opiate, it can only be for 7 days. It has to be a short acting for an incident. So that would be like a Lortab or a Vicodin, something like that, a short acting opiate. And only 7 days. And then if you need more, you go back to the doctor. Yeah.
So, you know, when my husband had his hip replaced, mm-hmm. when I had my shoulder replaced, they gave us, you know, like oxycodone, big bottle of it.
Yep.
So they're going to stop doing that?
Yep.
Because first of all, you really don't even...
It's ludicrous.
It is ludicrous.
Yeah, it's ludicrous.
I mean, we just... We
got rid of them.
Yeah.
We got in big trouble. Big trouble. But that is, by law, they can't do it anymore.
Good.
Now, a long-acting opiate like OxyContin, that can be ordered for a long-term issue. OxyContin was that was for end-stage cancer treatment.
Right.
We used it for everything. It's ridiculous. So, I mean, there's all these different pieces. It's after the fact, yes. But we got to stop the entry into the system. We're going to see a lot of people coming up in these drugs that are going to be like switching over to street drugs. It just is what it is at this point now. Not every state in the country has an internet prescribing law. They're getting there. They're getting there, slow but sure. And they're all different. Like Pennsylvania says they have one, but it's a weekly data dump, so it's not real time. So you can still doctor shop and get lots of scripts. Vermont doesn't have one, so I'm learning more about this. Naloxone access. Every state in the country, except for Wyoming, by the end of the year, will have a similar law here where you can just go to a drugstore and buy the stuff without a prescription. It's that state, that's why. It's not like there's a lot of controversy out there, Richie, about that. Because of epinephrine, we've heard this in schools, I hear this every time. Just an FYI, you can kill someone with epinephrine. You can't kill someone with epinephrine. Yes?
Okay, I apologize.
No problem. No dumb questions.
So you said that this new stuff, heart and lungs to stop. If we have a student who is passed out and we don't know what they take,
that's an opiate.
So the Narcan would help.
Yep. Yeah, the lean is made with an opiate. It's made with codeine. Codeine is an opiate.
Okay.
Yeah, codeine is an opiate. So absolutely.
If you have a student that's passed out, would you use
Narcan? Absolutely.
Even though you don't know
what they take. It's a do no harm drug. It's a rule out. So get it in their system. First thing you're doing, though, is call 911. But get the drug, get the Narcan into their system so it starts working. If it's not that, oh well, you give them wet nose. You know, no biggie. No biggie at all. EMS has used Narcan forever as a triage drug. They come up on man down, don't know what's going on. First thing you do is give them some Narcan before you start pounding on their chest.
Here's one of the things is how many of you have seen an overdose? They look dead. You're not detecting the breathing, you may not get a heart rate, if they're turning color in front of you, they basically look dead. Most times they're not dead, but you know, if there's some function going on, this is where the Narcan is going to hopefully save them. The thing though is you can't save everybody, and we've learned that. I mean, we've gotten there like real quick after somebody used, and they're dead.
The fentanyl is really fast acting. Is there internet in here? Yeah. Here, let me see if I can show you something here. I'm gonna show you the knot. Does anyone know what I'm talking about? The opiate nod?
How much time do you have, you know, after someone's taken heroin?
The rule of thumb is do it as quick as
possible because
we don't know. We don't know what it is that they're taking. We don't know the purity. We don't know the strength. You know, they get one that's more heroin than fentanyl, one that's more fentanyl, one that's more cutting.
Here we go.
We don't know.
This is the opiate nod, folks. This is a young man at work, and I will address that with you. And this is really disturbing because think about this. Look at this person. Could be one of your students, huh? This is real. The nod's a state of semi-consciousness. They know what's going on around them. And they really, truly believe they're responding appropriately. Like if you were like, hey, you're not now, they'd be like, no, I'm not. You can have that argument all day. It's a state of semi-consciousness. If you look at this, to me the most disturbing part of this is coworkers taping this and putting it on YouTube like it's okay. Like this is normal. But what you're seeing there, that's real, folks. And nobody is that tired. No one at all is that tired. You can go on YouTube, you can Google heroin nod, you can Google opiate nod, you'll see all kinds of things like this. If you look at this, someone must have said something to him, he'll look over like, what, huh? Where, who?
Now, is he overdosing? Is this an overdose?
This is a state of intoxication. At this point now, you'd never be able to give him Narcan. At this point, what I would do is, see if you watch him here. He'll respond.
I would call 911 at that point, let them deal with them. Let them deal with them. I'm done with them at that point. Let the police deal with them, because they can deal with them. They can 2209 them. The issue is here, when someone is in that state, you don't know, are they going up? Are they coming down? You got no idea. If it is a prescription drug, that takes a little bit of time to get into your system. You don't metabolize it like this. If it's fentanyl, it's like boom. Fentanyl is the one where we hear people are frozen in time. I've heard this from people in classes. I had one woman say she found her niece in front of her dresser just frozen on her knees in time. Overdosed. Because fentanyl works that fast. It's that fast. Now, if someone was doing that NAS thing, at that point, I'd call 911. I'd say, I think I got an opiate overdose. I need you to come here. They're still responding a little, but they're gone. If you try to give them Narcan, they'd be like, get away from me. Especially someone that's been reversed before, to answer your question, nobody wants to get reversed. If they've been reversed before and they're in that state, they'd be like, just leave me alone. I'll just die.
You got to know, sad. When we 2209 somebody, we're not arresting them. We're just taking them to the hospital. There's no criminal record, nothing. Because a lot of people are afraid, oh, you know, I don't want my kid getting arrested. We're not arresting your kid. We're getting them medical treatment. It would be the same as any shop teachers here. If a kid cuts a finger off in shop. That never happens, I know. Well, most shop teachers are missing fingers, I think.
You know, this kind of stuff here, folks. They're still responsive. The difference in an overdose would be that person, that kid that's laying there, and I went, hey, you're over here? They hit the floor instead. Where do we find people? Bathrooms, bedrooms, cars seem to be really problems, seem to be places. Think about it. They sit on a toilet and do whatever it is that they're going to do. And then they're out and gravity takes them. You've got this pretzel between the toilet and the wall. Literally between the toilet and the wall. In a car. Very prevalent places. Over a steering wheel. Wrapped in the gear shift. Think of how gravity would take someone when they pass out. When you come on someone like that, you're like, you in there? Anybody in there? No response. Next thing you're going to do is called a sternal rub. You take your knuckles and you rub really hard on that sternum bone. You're trying to hurt them. If they're messy, you know, the face planted, they're bloody, do that mom thing. Put a good pinch under the arm. Like, are you in there? You're trying to hurt them. Like, are you in there? Because if they're non-responsive, that's when you have to act ASAP. You've got to get some Narcan in them. If you don't get Narcan in them at that point, they are going to die. So, I mean, it's really, and we don't know what's in those little bags out there. We have absolutely no idea. People will tell you, well, I just bought a dose of medicine. I'm like, no, that's dope, and there's no doses that's a bag. But this is how this drug steals your brain. They know what's in that little bag is going to make them feel okay so they can function. Really scary. That and I trained SWAT, Buffalo SWAT. It was an interesting, I learned things every time. They're like, well, of course when we see a van that says construction, painting, blah, 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 we know what they're doing out there behind things. And they're like, holy moly. They're aware of it. People functioning, going to work. So in an overdose, they're non-responsive. Shallow breathing can occur. Could be no breathing. And they change colors quick. Around the lips, around under the eyes, fingernails, they change color quick. So fatal to overdose is death. Majority of the overdoses are witnessed. We told you who's doing it.
Next thing is, if you're a policeman, you can prevent calling 911. If you remember a while ago, there was the billboards that went up, don't run, call 911. What happens is a lot of people will overdose. Who's ever there with them will take off. If you're with somebody in the overdose, what's the first thing the other person's going to do? Is it run? No, the first thing they can do is take their stuff, and then they're going to run. That happens all the time. But the laws have changed. There's 911 Good Samaritan Law, which I'll talk about in a little bit. A 9/11 Samaritan law covers the caller and or the person that's overdosing from arrest and prosecution for specific things. It only covers them. You know, if they're calling for themselves because they're overdosing, how's that happen? We get 9/11 calls all the time. I just used heroin. I came in an overdose. I'm in a red car in Topps parking lot at Amherst and Grant. Not that it happens in the Topps parking lot at Amherst and Grant on a daily basis. But when we get there, we find the red car and there's a person who's overdosing or the person that they're calling for. It protects the two of them for that. The other thing is witnesses may try ineffectual things. We're finding this through the reports we get. Here's what's been documented on the reports of what does not work when somebody overdoses. If somebody overdoses, don't fill a syringe with milk and inject it into them. Don't make up your own saline solution of table salt and water. Doesn't work. Don't put them in a tub full of cold water or ice. Doesn't work. Last one, we're not really sure where this came from, but we've seen it a couple times already. Don't pick the groin area and armpits and ice. It doesn't work. Only Narcan works. But we get these all the time, that people are trying these things.
Pick their what?
Groin area and armpit and ice.
This is a new favorite.
The thing is, we know we're going to the internet, and because that's where everybody gets their information from. If it's on the internet, it must be true, correct? The only thing I can compare this to is that whole misconception of, what do you give to somebody that's really drunk? Coffee, right? Yeah, it doesn't sober them up. You have a wide awake drunk now. That's it. But people are finding this.
The only thing that works is Narcan, folks. That's it. Narcan. And we really, and people truly believe this. I think drug users believe this. I had a gentleman stand up in class that said, yup, worked on me. They stuck ice in my underwear. I'm like, oh my God. I'm like, you weren't overdosed. You know, you just, I don't know what to tell you. You weren't overdosed. The only thing that works is Narcan.
The one thing that I do want to mention is, this is always pushed off from the heroin point of view, opiates are opioids, whether they're prescription drugs or they're heroin. Narcan works on everybody. We've had three cases that were not heroin related. We had two cancer patients that screwed up their meds. They overdosed, they got Narcan, you know, they live. The third one is one you don't hear about. It's a four-year-old kid that got into the medicine cabinet, got into the pills, because what do pills look like to a four-year-old? Throw a handful down, and before you say, why weren't they in a childproof container? Who can open up childproof containers? Kids. Kid got Narcan and lived. The other thing we really wanted to say, and you know, we always tell them when we do the community trainings, is if they're presenting as an overdose, I don't ever assume, but assume it's an overdose, even if there's needles that aren't present. Again, this whole fentanyl mix has changed things, how people are using. They're going to the street drugs, and it's always going to be, I'm never going to use a needle. And they've made this new drug attractive. You can smoke it, you can snort it. We have one documented case where we got to the kid to the ER, kept Narcaning him, up, down, and they couldn't figure it out. Strip him down looking for a fentanyl patch, because sometimes they still use those, can't find the patch. Somebody looks, there's a string. They pulled the string out. He had a tampon that he had inserted into himself because he had coated it with the drug because he wasn't going to use a needle. So,
there's all these ways, folks. Drug cartels are very smart. They're businessmen. They created a product that would be amenable to people that are like, I'm not a drug user. Are you crazy? I'm just using medicine. So, I showed you how this works. Narcan is the only thing that reverses an overdose. Just remember that. It's an opiate antagonist. It does nothing to you if you do not have opiates in your system. Just a placeholder. The nasal Mornax tastes like crap, like you described it, but that's kind of what it tastes like. It tastes like crap. I've taken a lot of it to show a local law enforcement and first responders that I'm not dead. Because they're afraid of it. If you don't have a load of opiates on it, it doesn't do anything to you, okay? I hope you may do anything.
Cheryl would stand in front of a police group of police officers and sprayed up her nose, and she tells it hasn't affected her. Jury's
it's
out
like
on
crack.
That.
No, it just is. You know, you can't be afraid of it. That's my message. The other thing is, remember, our drugs are so strong. Manufacturer will tell you 30 to 90. Around here, it only lasts about 20 minutes. So, like we told you all, this part routinely has been used by EMS. I have a piece I'll leave for you today about how you can get Narcan at a drugstore. Please leave this for your parents and families. All health insurance is covered. If they're on Medicaid, you've got better coverage for that. It's kind of good. And I will share you a good news thing. We got into this from prescribing, and I don't know if you've heard this, Jeff. We got into this mess from prescribing. For the first time ever, we track all this stuff in public insurance. Medicaid, the last quarter, our number one drug was not OxyContin.
Yay.
Anyone know what it was? Made my day. Ibuprofen. First time ever. So we're changing. Now realize public insurance is we always have an eyeglass on. We monitor those things. Private insurers, that's a different ball of wax. But the first time ever, that's huge. Forever, it's been an opiate. But OxyContin, actually. So this kind of program we're training you under, there's over 300 programs, actually probably about 500 programs in New York State that do the same thing now. Because this epidemic is everywhere. Closest to us in New York State, probably Nassau, Suffolk County, when we're looking at demographics, number of deaths, socioeconomics, all that kind of thing. So, and there are a huge issue there. Long Island, a very affluent community. So, Boston, Mass.
Boston started the whole naloxone program. The Boston, Mass has a huge heroin problem. We started this years ago. Hundreds of reversals, we've had hundreds of reversals. No significant complications of patients? We've had no significant complications of patients. Most important thing up here for us and for you is no injuries to providers. Like I told you, we've used it so many times in Buffalo Police Department. You know, not only we have not had a single injury to anybody that has done it, fire department has not had any injuries. So the best thing we can tell you is if you get Narcan and they come out of it, step behind them. They're going to throw up.
This is nasal Narcan. That's what I'm going to leave for you today. I would recommend, I've checked my health insurance. I get this for a $15 copay. I get two of these in a package. If you know that you have a family member or a friend, you know someone down the street, recommend this to them. This is so much easier, let me tell you. And the fact that we use 3 to 4 vials of Narcan at most reversals, this is two.
So that's 2 vials and you get 2 of those?
Yeah, so you get, this is 2.
Two boxes of this is one of those.
Yeah.
And we started in South Buffalo.
Yeah. And I will tell you, we're doing a little pilot there, a couple of police and fire. What I am seeing from fire, and I got to get police's records, they seem to be reversing people with one of these. So that's pretty good. Because I think it's a more intense dose of medication all at once. All it is like magnetic pull. And we have so much fentanyl around here, it takes a lot of this crap to kick it off of the receptor site. So. I mean, this is what schools can get. This company, Adapt Pharma, is a new product. They will provide schools a couple doses for free. I'll send Betty the link and you can send it out to everybody. That would be good. It's an application you can do. Anything to get stuff in your hands. If you're setting up a school program and have naloxone in your school, I recommend you put it in your AEDs. Most AEDs are connected to some kind of 911 response, so it calls 911 for you. So you don't even have to think about it. Because if you think you see an overdose, first thing you got to do is call 911. Just for the fact that you're playing out, you're just going to have enough of this. You got to send them to the hospital. Go away, go to the hospital. Get 911 coming. If they leave the hospital, let me tell you, they're going to run. 90% of people that go to the hospital run. They're going to get checked in. They are gone because they are so sick. They're just trying to feel okay. So you do the best.
Question. Do they incur medical bills?
Yeah.
For this? For the ambulance?
For the ambulance? For the
annual
appointment, the
person who... Yeah, but a lot of those bills aren't just paid. Check with BCMC or Boss General to see how much you get reimbursed by the government.
Especially if they never check it.
But they keep treating them. They have to by law. So we're giving you the intranasal. You're going to see the intramuscular out there with the big heavy needles. They give those to people through the needle exchange program because they're used to using needles. A lot of us, most of us aren't. We give you this because as you look around the world, everybody has a nose. Your nose is always there. We don't have to strip you down because if you're doing the intramuscular, it's going to go in the arm, the rear end, or the thigh. This is just a lot easier. It cuts down on accidental needle sticks for the blood splatter if you're injecting a needle. If you do, for whatever reason, get an accidental needle stick or some sort of exposure, immediately go to the hospital. You don't know what their behaviors or where that needle's been. In a woman that her son overdosed, for whatever reason, she's next to him, she sweeps her hand under the bed, the needle's stuck in her finger. Cheryl told us about needle sharing. We train pharmacists and they tell us how people come in, I want one needle. Well, they're 10 for $5, I want one, but it's still $5. You buy the one needle, go out, sit in the car, prep your kit, shoot up, and pass that same needle off to the person next to you. Don't know why. So again, you don't know where the needle's been, and you don't know what their behaviors have been.
This hijacks your brain, folks.
So there's no risk,
depending on like the low heavy
narcotics, like 80 pounds. There's no problem with their small. To use it on a small person? Oh, no, no. No, no risk at all. The only difference in dosage is if you have under a 2-year-old. And it's half the dosage, and it's just because there's no space in here, plain and simple. There's no space. They just don't think about their head smaller. They have smaller sinus cavities.
It's do no harm. If you give it to somebody that there's no opioid, it makes the inside of their nose white. That's it.
Yeah.
It's only going to work if there's an opioid present.
After about 2 years. About 2 years. There's an expiration date. She's asking questions here that I know everybody heard. There's an expiration date on the vial and on the box, usually about 2 years out. If you come on a scene, it's expired, use it anyway. It's not going to hurt anyone. It's a drug that doesn't go bad. It's a drug that hypothetically gets weaker.
Temperature sensitive,
room temperature, folks.
Don't leave it in your car if you wouldn't leave your kid or dog in there. If it's too hot, it's going to make the medicine less effective. If it's too cold, it'll freeze. It's a fluid in a really thin glass vial. If your kids get into it at home and they drink it, it's not going to affect them. What's going to happen is they break that glass vial and cut themselves.
If there's an issue in a family, I would recommend that everybody get trained. By law, we provide anyone 16 and up kits of their own. They can go to the drugstore and get it themselves. We'll tell you once they go home, though, we tell people to train everyone in the family. Don't lock that kid up in a safe. That's silly. We've had people die because of that. I've had families come back and tell me that. On the other end of the world, people have done the right thing. We had a 10-year-old save his brother because the family went home and trained everybody in the house, and that's who happened to be at home. So, I mean, there's all these things. There's things I never thought I'd be telling people, ever in a million years. 911 Good Samaritan Law, and I'll cover that quickly, and then we're going to do a hands-on with Narcan.
Are you playing that movie?
Yeah.
Okay.
We'll do it. I'll bring all the kids in, and we have some trainers on the tables where you were, so you can hang on to them and play with them and see what they are.
And Hilbert just wants to, before we release everybody, Hilbert just wants to share with the folks some information.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. So before we do that, on your front page, your PowerPoint, you have demographic forms. That is what I'm going to collect from you for your kid at the end. I will give you a certificate of completion after you've demonstrated that you know how to use it. And you'll give me that form and you'll get your own kit. 911 Good Samaritan Law covers two people.
Here's the deal. 911 Good Samaritan Law covers the caller and or the person overdosing from arrest and prosecution for a few specific things. First thing being drugs up to an A2 felony. If we get there and there's up to 8 ounces of a narcotic substance, we're not going to arrest you. Next thing is alcohol. The big push for this law came from families of underage drinkers who didn't have good results. Because what happens in high schools and colleges is people aren't old enough to get really drunk. If your friend's not old enough to get really drunk, you let them sleep it off, except sometimes they have acute alcohol intoxication. Third thing is marijuana. If you come to your house because you called 911 for yourself or somebody else, and you have 30 bales of marijuana on your kitchen table, we're not going to arrest and prosecute you. Now ask me the question that everybody always asks.
Are you going to take it?
Are you going to take it? Yes, we are. Everybody seems to ask that. Followed up by what you guys do with it. They tell them we burn it. I get a smile. In an industrial incinerator, there's no downwind. People keep asking these questions. Paraphernalia and sharing of drugs will not be arrested. If we get there and there's paraphernalia, or if we finally do share drugs with somebody, you're not going to be arrested. In New York State, there's no such thing as gifting drugs to somebody. If you're going to be a really good friend and give your friend a bag of weed for their birthday, you've committed a sale. Even though there's been no financial or exchange of services, it's still considered a sale. But we're not going to arrest you for these things. What we are going to arrest you for is A1 felony. If there's more than 8 ounces of narcotic substance, we're going to arrest you. Next thing is any sort of parole, probation, warrant type of thing. This isn't get out of jail free. You can still be arrested for those things. Some peripheral things we can't arrest you for. Depew Police about 2 years ago got a call. Babies, mother, overdosing, father calls. They get there, they take care of her. Drugs and needles all over the house. They didn't arrest him for that. They did arrest him for the reckless endangerment of the children. It became a CTS case. And he had a prior felony conviction, and there was a weapon in the house. He got arrested for that.
It's not free ride to kill the kids. People get all, you know, they get bent about that. I do want to show you that's a report form. If you use your kids, fill it out to the best of your ability. It is in your package. On the last slide of your PowerPoint is my contact information. If you use your kid, get a hold of me. I need to report to the state on that. If you lost your form, I'll fill out a form. Just to remember pertinent information. Male, female, age, time of day, zip code, how much you use. This is why we do this, folks. I don't want to put this in the paper anymore. I just really don't want to put this in the front page of Buffalo News. How do I ever have to do this? Realize this is somebody's somebody. Everybody up there is somebody's someone. I come down on the rights of my sister. That's what we got to do, folks. That's what I'm calling. We've got to talk about this. We've got to break the stigma. Jessica brought that up. We've got to break the stigma. We've got to talk about it. My family dealt with this for 30 years. We didn't ask for that crap. I got two kids without parents, and that's what you're going to see in your schools. So, everybody's somebody's somebody. And nobody wants to be a girl yet. Let me tell you. So, I want to thank you for this. Over the past stuff I want to tell you. When you're done here, we're going to go out to the tables where you were, do a hands-on, get you your own kits and your certificates. I've got lots of literature there for you.
Okay, can I help you? I'll help you read it out. Thank you, Cheryl.
Looks like this. Please take it, okay?
Thank you for what you do. My high school counselor put me on the career path to where I am. He told me no chance I'm going to be an astronaut. Apparently, NASA has a weight limit, and it would be a lot more
violent. All right, I just want to take up just one quick minute of your time. If you didn't know where you parked today, you are at Hilbert College. So, welcome. Thanks for skipping school to come hang out with us today. It does mean a lot, and as you know, I got to meet most of you guys. For those of you I didn't, my name is Jake Gale. I'm the Director of Admissions here. I also want to introduce our crew. Ted Malwitz helped put this on today. And we have Ann Continetti and Juliet Tallarico with us here as well. So we're the admissions crew. If you walk away today, you want to share this place with any students, feel free to get a hold of us. We can come back, plan a visit. We'd love to have you guys here. If anything includes good. So, and then before we do the final training, we do have our tour guides here. If anyone would like to do a quick loop around campus, it is a slide riding tour. If anyone's interested. Thanks for coming. Hopefully, you guys have a good day. Let us know what
we think. We thank all of you. It was a great venue, great food, and great company. So.
Just give a couple real quick updates and then we'll get going. We do want to thank Betty, obviously, for all her work on doing this in Iroquois. It's our tradition. We do have some Barnes & Noble gift cards where Mary might be, so we'll get you something, so I appreciate it. We appreciate it. National Grid, maybe a couple months ago, had a workshop for us, and they really wanted to do some outreach for the counselors. One of the things that they also agreed to do and follow through with is we have some engineering books on careers and jobs. So I have that very heavy box waiting. So please take that so it's a little bit lighter, but I haven't looked through it yet. It just kind of came from Jody today. So that will be very helpful, I think, to look through and to work to use with your students. So we have that. The next meeting is going to be January 13th. Mary Vale, do you want to talk a little real quick about it? Other than,
well, I know Kelly's doing a great job organizing
it. Yes. So I
cooked your memos. So okay. Yes, it's a go.
Mark just sent it out last night, so you should have access to that. That's going to be at the UV Center tomorrow. Steve Harvey, who has really kind of helped us get up and running with our website maybe 6 years ago, has a program on college transition that we thought would be appropriate and wanted to have him have a chance to share some of his knowledge. So that will be, is on your email list if you haven't opened it yet, that was sent last night. We also, I don't know if you had gotten some stuff early on this year, we had received some information about Raise.me, the scholarship piece, and I don't really know a lot about it. I think Tonawanda had inquired about it as well. So we called them. I called them in the early fall, and so the date that seemed to work was in January. So they're.
I think Kelly's been in contact. We just did talk about this, so they're trying to figure out how to do it.
Yeah, they're in California. They're not going to be physically here, but they're going to do a conference call. I think it's something along the lines where the students can accumulate points or credits almost, and then present that to a college, and the college will then grant you scholarship money based on maybe those points or those accomplishments. So still trying to figure it out myself, but it seems to be something that maybe we're getting more of. I know Gannon was a school that had sent me something, and there was one other school. I don't know if anybody else has kind of gotten information. So we'll see if we can pull that off just to get more information. I've got a couple of emails about internships for students, one from Duval College looking for a home, and then Cortland has sent us something. If you have any interest and you'd want to be a volunteer for those students and take them on, that would be great, and you can reach out to me just because they're in need of a practicum site. We're up to about 15 or so sponsors, which, you know, I'm proud of. We've been able to try to really, and Hilbert being one of them as well, which is really just a good partnership with a lot of our local schools. So again, if you have any connections with schools or businesses that might be appropriate for us, it's $250 for the year, and it just allows us to do much more outreach with students and with just opportunities that we may have in the future. Kyle has been coming now. This is his second time from Harkness. He's basically now taping our programs. You're here, so obviously you may or may not need him, although this probably would help to have some refresher information. So we're getting closer. I think we will be getting close to having it then on YouTube, which then will be on our website. So if you know people that haven't been here, couldn't make it, you can't make a meeting coming up. We're hoping to kind of make this real, but it's not as seamless as I would like it to be, but we're getting closer. So that's kind of on the works. We're also trying to develop a logo for our organization, something that kind of we can work on. We also are working with Harkness on that. I haven't reached out to you guys yet. We're still moving along slowly, but once I feel like we have a little bit more direction, I may reach out to you, and if you have any artistic or creative ability or know somebody, you can kind of give us your input to see if it's something that we can kind of gravitate to. So that's sort of in the maybe middle stage of that excitement. Anybody else have anything? Maybe Wes Seneca, are you still here? I thought maybe you had something, I don't know, still here. Okay, so not yet. Okay, so she can reach out if there's any questions about the career plan. What's it?
Yeah, about the program.
Okay, so there might be some questions that we can respond to. Anybody else have anything that they want to share?
I would just encourage folks to reach out to both Jess and Cheryl. We have really a strong partnership with both of them. Jess does many presentations at our school. Cheryl did come in and she not only trained our coalition, but she also trained our staff as well, obviously with the permission of the high school principal. So certainly reach out to any of them. They're a great, great resource.
And continue to use the website. You know, I just went on yesterday during school, and there still are a lot of questions that people are posing, things that, of course, always relate to us. So it's a good way to get information. It's a good way, obviously, to get to the person asking the question.
Thank you for having me.
If you continue to do that, that would be good. Didn't catch that time.
For the books.
Okay. So if you're going to take a book or when you take a book, Jody has the checklist. Just to let you know. Mark, anything on your end? Okay. Terry? Good. Okay, so we'll go back to this.